Hey, everybody. Welcome to Write On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is the show where we talk about all things screenwriting. Today, we have an interview with Zach Baylin, Academy Award nominated writer of the Academy Award nominated film King Richard.
What's going on? Everybody okay?
They got a call, said there was trouble in the house.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, you all need to look around.
It's a little wet for practice, don't you think? Don't the girls have schoolwork to do?
They do their homework. Tundi's first in her class. Lynn and Isha are too.
Now, I don't even mind you saying we hard on these kids. You know why? Because we are. That's our job, to keep them off these streets. You want to check on the kids? Let's check on the kids. We got future doctors and lawyers, plus a couple tennis stars in this house.
The chances of achieving the kind of success that you're talking about is just very, very unlikely.
Okay, you're making a mistake, but I'm gonna let you make it. Watch me hit a few balls.
All right.
So tell me your names again.
I'm Venus.
I'm Serena.
Write On's Sade Sellers chatted with Zach about his research process, how he found the core of the story and decided to make Richard the protagonist, getting the blessing of the Williams family to make the film with some help from Will Smith, and more. Check it out.
Welcome back to Write On Podcast, everyone. It is Sade here again, and I'm here talking with screenwriter Zach Baylin about King Richard. Okay, Zach, I watched this movie over Thanksgiving break. I believe it was I was home for Thanksgiving with my mom. And I just wanted to let you know, Oscar buzz aside, my mom gave it the seal of approval. So now you know it's a legit winner.
Oh, amazing. That's high praise, I'm sure. Thank you.
Nadia does not like many films, but she liked this one.
Awesome. Thanks so much. That's great.
I want to go back to the beginning. I did something I do when I watch any film, as I deep dive into any article, any IMDb trivia I can find. And I found out that you had put this script up on the blacklist and that you got a high score. But I feel like there's a little bit more to the story before the blacklist. So I want to know, when was the first time you were approached or the idea for King Richard touched you? Like, when did this all start?
Yeah, it's actually a pretty cool story that I had been just on a general meeting with a producer in New York about a different project, this guy, Tim White, who was one of the producers of the movie. And we were just talking about other books, other projects that we both had in development. And before I left the meeting, I mentioned to him that I was going to the US Open because I'm like a big tennis fan. And I was living in New York at the time. And Tim basically said, he was like, well, you know, if you like tennis, maybe sit back down for a minute because I have an idea for a movie and I've been trying to figure it out. So that was sort of the inception point for me that, you know, Tim had been a junior tennis player, like a very high level player around the same time as Venus. And he had been trying to crack a movie about like the Williams family and about Richard. And I just like fell in love with it immediately. I had written something previously a couple of years before. Like the first thing I ever sold was a TV show that was loosely set in the world of tennis. So I knew enough about the family and about Richard to know that it had the bones of like really incredible story. And, you know, and then I just went about and did a ton of research. So I had this like one weekend where I think they were about to hire another writer. And I had essentially told them, I'm like, well, give me a weekend. Let me see if I can at least crack what I think the heart of the story is and what I would do with it. Cause I really just didn't, I don't know, you know, it was one of those few times where like a piece of material comes up or a story and you just know it has the potential to be really, really special. And then you're just going to kick yourself afterwards if you don't find a way to at least get a shot to be involved in it. And I went away and I probably read like four books in a weekend about Richard and about Venus and Serena's early days and fell like I had found the core of the story, you know, the story about Richard, you know, really that Richard as a protagonist being the guy who had kind of conceived of this crazy idea, but that, you know, as someone who could also be self-sabotaging and might screw up the goals that he had set out and ultimately would have to hand over the spotlight to Venus and Serena, really allow it to be their stories moving forward. And I wrote Tim and his brother Trevor like an email that weekend that I still have that basically is like, here's the movie. It should start here. It should end with this Vicario match. And, you know, it's really about you know, Richard trying to find self-respect and actually having to acquiesce his agency to Venus and Serena. And they said, okay, we won't hire this other person. Why don't you give it a shot?
That's amazing to hear. I want to get more technical. Like, was it an outline? Was it a treatment? Was it like a synopsis? Like, what did you actually send?
It was somewhere in between. I mean, it wasn't an outline, but it basically, I said, I think this is the core of what Richard's character is, you know, that he's someone who would, because a real eye-opening moment for me, just in research, and it happened really early, was just really discovering what Richard's childhood had been. And, you know, he was a guy, it's alluded to in the movie, but he had grown up in Shreveport, Louisiana, in like the depths of poverty and terrible racism, and had many encounters with like the KKK, and had really like barely escaped with his life, and had left Louisiana like on a real American dream story to try and like, I'm going to put my stamp on my life and on the world somehow, and prove that I deserve to not just have respect, but to succeed and be, you know, be as fulfilled a life as I deserve. And that he took many different paths to try and find that for himself and with his, you know, in his life, that he had been a failed entrepreneur many times over. That kind of inherent, just like, this guy was going to succeed or die trying, was, I felt like what the heart of his character story could be. And I said it, you know, it has to be a story about a guy who's trying to find self-respect, but doesn't really necessarily have it for himself yet. And that it could start at this moment in late 80s, early 90s, where the family has had this really improbable idea that they're going to raise tennis champions, you know, in Compton without any resources, without either of them ever having played tennis before, Richard or his wife, Orsine. And to start it at the moment where like all the chips were on the table, and it was either they're going to hit the jackpot or they were going to bust. And that, you know, when I walked it through, I think then they go to Macy's, you know, then they go to Paul Cohen and they go to Macy's, and it leads up to this final pro match. Or Venus's first pro match. And that was all in the outline. It was, or excuse me, in that email, which was probably like, you know, just like a 2-page vomit of ideas that I sent out, really.
So was the angle of always coming from Richard's side yours, or was that always something they wanted? Because a lesser writer and producer would have said, let's focus on Venus and Serena, which is like, the memories, you know, young children like that, you don't really get the same gravitas as you do when you see it from a parent who's like, everything is riding on these kids.
Yeah. I mean, that's how I felt. I felt that, you know, for people who don't know the story or haven't seen it, you know, Richard saw the like 1978 French Open and saw a woman get a check for, I don't remember the exact amount now, like, you know, $45,000, and, you know, had this burst of inspiration that was totally insane, but basically said, you know, if we had two more children, we could probably raise them to be better athletes than this woman. They could be successful in this sport. And it would be a real F you to like the world that we're trying to break into. And it would be really symbolic, and it would be great. But he didn't have any, you know, he had never played tennis before. They had no resources. He really didn't have any idea necessarily of what the obstacles would be, but he wrote out this plan and he decided to follow it, and he got the whole family on board. So, you know, that felt to me like that was such a natural kind of character inciting point, you know? And so it, for me, and I also think for Tim and Trevor, the, you know, the producers, the two producers before Will came on board and became the third, that we all saw that as a really great sort of entry point to the story. And then, yeah, for me, I think that people's memory, obviously, in researching and talking to them over a course of a number of years and thinking about I don't remember what happened when I was 10.
Yeah, me either.
I don't remember what dinners were like or what, you know, you have these little, you know, your memories and the stories, they get kind of calcified into these legends that you tell over and over again.
But, or you're so protected as children, you don't get to hear all the bad things that happen.
Exactly. I think that Richard and Orsine, their mother, did an incredible job of shielding them from the, you know, the harder parts of the world that they were facing. And they created a bubble around them that enabled them to, you know, to walk through these experiences as undeterred as possible. But I don't, you know, Richard was just like, he was such a dynamic guy. It was what you look for in any kind of protagonist, anytime that he had a very distinct voice. He was really driven, had a very clear goals that he wanted to achieve, but he was also, he could be incredibly self-defeating and self-sabotaging, and he could get in his own way and other people's way. And that just felt like such a compelling character to me. But we knew that people would come into it really with a awareness of Venus and Serena and no one else. And so, you know, how to kind of write those two sides of things was a challenge. And I thought it became inherent in the story because it is going to become Venus and Serena's story.
Yeah.
But first, Richard has to like recognize that that is the case. And he's got to learn that he's got to get the hell out of the way, kind of. And that's where the movie is.
I learned a lot. You know, I grew up watching Venus and Serena as well. I played tennis in high school and I loved it. And it was something I never thought I would go do it professionally, but I just loved doing it. And then I remember very vividly, my sister joined my junior year. She joined the tennis team. She's a year below me. And my coach, his eyes lit up because he's like, I have my next Venus and Serena. And no, he didn't. Mm-hmm. She was awful. My sister's 6'1", so she's very tall, but she's very awkward. And tennis was not her game. So she quit. it's interesting to watch the film back, because I thought, I always assumed it was Serena who kind of like grazed first. And then to watch the film, I go, oh my gosh, it was Venus. And like, she had the first Nike deal and she was doing this. I learned so much from just rewatching your film that I thought I knew and I didn't. So you presented it to Tim. He liked the story. He got rid of that other writer. Sorry, other writer, but I know your future is probably going to be fine. You're going to do other things.
I'm sure they're doing great. I don't know who it is, but
I don't know who it is, but what's the next steps? I mean, between yes, we want to hire you, and like, now you got to actually do everything that you promised that you would do.
Yeah. Well, so then came, you know, a caveat that I think I knew when he first told me the story, but they didn't have the rights to any of the family. Tim had tried to reach out to Venus in the past and had, you know, I think had not been able to contact her. So collectively we all sort of agreed, okay, if this movie has a real chance, then what we're going to need to do is have a script that really is very representative of what we think the movie can be, because this is my first produced credit. I didn't have any credits, you know, that if we were to like try and knock on Serena's door and say like, hey, can we make a movie about you? That she was probably going to say like, get the hell out. And we decided that I would write the script and then try and use that as like the calling card and say, here is specifically the movie that we want to make, you know? And so I went off and I wrote, you know, for a couple of months. I researched, talked to people kind of peripherally to them, came up with a script, and that's the script that ended up on the blacklist. So
can I ask a personal question? You cannot answer it, but I'm very curious, because this is a writing podcast and I'm sure everyone's, were you paid for that time?
I was paid. Yeah. So okay. I got to their immense credit. So they did not pay me very much, you know,
right. At
the beginning point. But what happened that went on is that, you know, I was paid a nominal like scale fee or something for that draft. And then that script got to Will Smith, and Will Smith like conditionally signed on, basically say like, I would like to do this if the family gives their blessing to the movie. But so then we still had to go, the producers and myself, and, you know, tried to make inroads with the family and to say like, to have them read it. But then also, you know, I knew that there were going to be things that I was not able to access and research. Mm-hmm. And I really wanted to sit down and talk to Orsine and sit down and talk to Venus and Serena, and that the script was never going to be, it had been well received, but it was never going to be as maybe nuanced as it needed to be. And so eventually that happened. We were able to sit down with them and they read the script and said, okay, like if you're, you know, if this is a story you want to tell, if you're willing to sit down and sort of hear our experience, then yeah, we'll come on board. And once that happened and the script then was able to go out to like market to the studios, Tim and Trevor and the producers renegotiated like my deal. so that okay. I can participate. In-
so yeah. you can, yeah, it's probably, okay. Well, that's good to hear. I mean, but the, it feels like, or it sounds like there's a lot of leap of faith in here. You had to take a leap of faith to work with these producers, to do with their job. They took a leap of faith. You, you had no credits. And then Will's taking the leap of faith, joining in saying, I'll do this, but I need this. And then obviously Venus and Serena and the whole family taking a leap of faith to go this, okay, this is appropriate for this story to be told. So a lot of trust needing to be exchanged here.
It was, I mean, there were a lot of hurdles that I often go back and I can't believe we made it over all of them. And I, you know, there were many times where we had the script and felt like, you know, we had gotten great reception. And a lot of people were interested in making the movie if, you know, if we were able to get through the next like hurdle. And, you know, there were a lot of, and I had, I don't know, personally, I mean, I had so much riding on it just in terms of, I believed in it so much if it could see, if it could get there. And there were many days I remember like just emailing back and forth with Tim and Trevor, just like, do you ever think that we will get to make this movie? And some days we were like, yes, it's going to happen. And other days it was like, this is never going to happen. And it was, yeah, somehow we got there.
What did you do in between those moments where it's out of your hands? Cause you know, it's out of your hands.
Well, I mean, fortunately for me, like the script had been read at that point. And so, and, you know, I was working before, but, you know, I got into a lot of rooms that I probably wasn't, you know, didn't have access to before. So I had begun other scripts. You know, I was able to kind of bury myself in other work, which was great, but there was always a few hours of every day that was spent frantically texting with Tim and Trevor. If like, have you heard from Venus? Have you heard from Serena?
I'm sure that anxiety, you're glad that part of it is over. From the time you sat down with Tim in New York and to the time King Richard premiered last year, what's the year total? Just so our audience knows, this takes time.
I know it all pretty well. So basically I sat down with Tim at the 2017 US Open was like that first meeting.
Wow.
And then we met with Isha Price, who was one of their sisters, and Orosine, their mother, at the 2018 US Open. And they said they would come on board and help us with the movie. And then we went into production in the fall of 2019. So in some ways it happened, you know, really fast, but then we shut down for COVID in the middle of shooting in March of 2020. And then came back and finished the film that fall. And then it premiered, you know, fall of 2021, but it originally was supposed to come out fall of 2020 before we shut down.
That's still a good 5-6 years.
yeah. No, I mean, but I think in the scheme of things, it actually like from
pretty quick, but yeah,
pretty quick, but it doesn't feel quick when it's happening. You know,
right. It feels like, okay, how long is it going to be here?
Yeah.
I'm wondering to go back to, okay, the family's agreed to do the script and those moments that you did talk about, the things that you were just not going to get from previous interview tapes that you actually had to get from Venus Serena or the, you know, mom and sister. What were some of those questions you had for them?
I mean, there were a lot. Some of them were really mundane and you just want to know, like, what was your routine like when you woke up in the morning, as much as you can remember it? Because we knew that the movie was going to be condensed into like, you know, days. Like this is a day in the life that the movie kind of begins. And so like, where did you practice? How did you decide what courts you practice on? Were you in that van going to practice happily, or were you arguing and you didn't want to get out of bed? You know, just those kind of everyday questions to try and really center the film in specificity about this family, not just like a family that went through this. But then, you know, then some really difficult stuff. Like I think the first time I met with Orsine, there's a scene in the film where it's revealed that, you know, Richard had children in a previous relationship that he left, and that there's sort of a propensity in Richard's life to leave things unfinished.
Mm-hmm.
And that was always in the script. You know, I found that in my research, and Orsine read that the first day that we met her as she was going through the script. And, you know, she said, oh, okay, you want this to be in the movie? We're like, well, you know, I think if we're going to tell this story honestly, this has to be in there, and we have to
good and the bad.
Yeah, with the good and the bad. And to her credit, she said, okay, well, like if this is going to be in the movie, let me tell you how it actually happened. Let me tell you, like, let me tell you, like, you know, how I discovered that those children existed and what my reaction was and how that changed the way I, you know, approached my relationship with Richard and, you know, what our collective goals were as a family. And a lot of that stuff is verbatim in this big scene in the movie. And so there were a handful of things that, you know, really came out of those conversations. And a lot of the work was really about, once I was interviewing them, was really about her character and finding a way to make sure that because she was a very reserved person. She is a very reserved person, but is extremely confident, extremely assured of her beliefs. And she is not very verbose, but when she does speak, that there's a lot behind it. And
has something to say.
Has something to say. And that was tricky to get on the page because you're like, you have a character who maybe doesn't have the line count that someone like Richard, who is constantly talking, does, but finding a way to make sure as you're reading the script, like, is it coming through? Is the power of this character coming through and the agency that she has and the strength of character? And so, you know, I taped all my interviews with them and just listened to them all the time and try to make sure that the voice was right, all those things. And then, you know, many, many scenes. I mean, I think that, like, another scene I love, there's a scene later in the film where Orsine is braiding Venus and Serena's hair and, you know, giving them these beads that were very iconic in their playing career. Mm-hmm. And that, again, that had always existed in the script, but talking with Orsine about what, you know, what her intention was behind that, which is obviously was much more than some, you know, style decision that she made. It was really about asking Venus and Serena to wear their heritage proudly when they went on the court, to not act as if they need to blend in and belong, but no, they could be there as who they were and representing, you know, representing young Black women everywhere. And that, you know, making sure that scene was as powerful and important as it was, you know, came out of talking to her and came out of talking to Anjanou and, you know, how do we do this right?
Let me tell you, those beads, not only are they painful when they hit you in the face, but, you know, they make noise. I see the vision she had. I'm like, yes, the pride thing and everything. But I'm like, girl, you wanted them to know that they were on the court. That's exactly what you
did. They used to get a lot of crap from other players because it was distracting or, you know, there was some, I can't remember what tournament it was, but either Venus and Serena like caught a lot of crap because one of the beads like popped out during a point and the other player, you know, became very distracted.
I remember growing up and being very young, but, you know, having the same beads and the thought it was so cool to see Venus and Serena have them. They hurt like hell. I wanted to ask you, you touched on it briefly that you said you taped them because you're kind of like an anthropologist in the sense that you have to kind of gather all of these stories and then put them together. What is your workflow like when you're putting together a biopic? So is it tapes? Is it Google Drive? Are you a note taker?
Yes, it's all of it. You know, I'm like, I do tapes. You know, if I interview people, I ask. I don't do like the Michael Cohen thing, but I like, I ask if I can interview him, tape it. And then I go back and listen to that stuff and I write it down, or, you know, my wife helps me with the research sometimes. So she'll transcribe things. And then when I'm reading, you know, I just take copious notes of scenes that I think are relevant or little pieces of dialogue that I think will be useful somewhere and just put it into, you know, too many different things, notebooks and, you know, Google documents and all that stuff. And then at some point I start to like outline, but I will do some amalgamation of like an outline and note cards so that like, if, as I'm outlining, I know, oh, I read this great anecdote about when Rick Macy arrived and met the family for the first time. And sometimes, you know, when you are outlining that stuff, you just feel an energy to start writing it. And so then it's useful for me to have like, okay, some expanded outline or note card thing where like, I can have dialogue and some other things in there.
Where does all this research live now? Is it hidden away in like a library somewhere?
I mean, it's, you know, it's all on like my computer, my iPhone, and I have all my, you know, I have the 24 books about Venus and Serena and all that that are still like annotated here. And then, you know, when the movie went into pre-production, I had all that stuff and I was able to share what I had with the, you know, researcher that Ronaldo Marcus Green, the director, brought on to, you know, to help him build out the movie. And so then we had a collective archive of things and I was on set every day of the movie. It was very lucky.
Oh, lucky. I know that doesn't happen a lot.
It doesn't. I think probably because I think the thing that I had to like fight for, I had ownership over, was that I, you know, at some point I felt like I had become kind of the authority of right. the Williams family in the world. And that at least that was valuable, even though I hadn't ever like been on set before.
Right. You were the trusted one who had all the secrets. Yeah. You did. I heard you mention earlier that you are a parent, and for all of my parents listening out there, I want to know, how do you organize your day with the kids and writing? That's a lot of commitment to be spread across.
Yeah. It became trickier once I had kids to try and figure out where and when I could write. But honestly, like my professional writing career really didn't get going until I had my daughter who's 8 now. And like, so the whole time that I've been like working in this capacity, I've had kids. So it's tricky. I say that they go to school and then I begin my day and I try to use the hours at my house where they are not here. And then when they come home, I either go and I go to a coffee shop or I try to go somewhere else where I can stay focused for another couple hours. And, you know, I find like I do work when they're in bed and I get back into a script, or I wake up in the middle of the night and I turn on my iPhone and I write some notes down that I like thought about in the middle of the night. And you're just kind of grabbing moments anytime you can.
I love that. And then last question before I let you go, since you already gave advice to the parents out there, now I want to go back to yourself before the kids, but as you're starting your writing journey. So what advice would you have for your younger writer self?
Do it better before earlier. I don't know. It took me a really long time. You know, I didn't sell a script until I was 34 or something. You know, and I was writing from the time I got out of college. I got out of college and I moved to New York and started working in film production solely with the purpose of like getting a job as a writer. And, but I think I worked on set, but I didn't really like meet a ton of other writers and I did it very in isolation. And I would say that was a big mistake. That I don't know if I was being too private about the fact that I wanted to do it, or that I felt, you know, I wasn't ready to show people that, but I've realized now that just like having that network around you of other people who are doing it, who can give you feedback and also give you encouragement, and the whole the networking aspect of it is so frustrating, but it's so necessary. And so I'd say, yeah, just like build a community. I wish I had done that.
I think that's solid advice. Zach, it's been great talking to you today. King Richard, again, is Nadia sealed approved? They need to make like a little gold emblem for Nadia approved movies. So I think it's just you and Journal for Jordan so far on her list.
You get it. Okay. Yeah.
Everyone else, you go watch the movie right now. It's streaming on HBO Max. It is such a joy, and about triumph and error and respect and family, especially family. I'm the oldest of 4. So I felt so many feelings watching this movie, especially when it comes to my younger siblings. Zach, stick around. We have a little gift for you, but everyone else, we'll see you next time on the show.
All right. Thank you so much. So great to be here.
Thanks to Zach Baylin for coming on the show. King Richard is in theaters and available on VOD platforms right now. And as always, thanks to you, our listeners. If you liked this episode, leave us a review. And if you haven't already, subscribe to the show on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. For news about new episodes and more, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter at Final Draft Inc., and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting. This podcast was produced by Kayla Guess and co-produced by Emma Vranich. Editing is by Sean Bonnet. Music is by T. Kelly. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, write on.